Madam Speaker, I have an amendment at the desk.
The clerk will designate the amendment.
Amendment number 22, printed in Part B of House Report Number 118-551, offered by Ms. Green of Georgia.
Pursuant to House Resolution 1287, the gentlewoman from Georgia, Ms. Green, and a member opposed each will control 5 minutes, and the chair recognizes the gentlewoman from Georgia.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. My amendment would basically say that no funds should be authorized to be appropriated in this act or otherwise made available for the Department of Defense for fiscal year 2025 may be used for electric vehicles or electric vehicle charging infrastructure. My amendment would ensure that no funds are authorized in this year's NDAA to be used on electric vehicles or electric vehicle charging infrastructure. Electric vehicles made up about only 7.6% of U.S. car sales in 2023 and remain a very small percentage of all cars nationwide. And the reason why that is because they're not popular, they're not practical, and none of Americans' hard-earned tax dollars should be used for our military to be forced onto electric vehicles. Automakers continue to report millions of dollars in losses on electric vehicles. They have already begun scaling back pronounced investments in electric vehicles to production targets more in line with consumer demand. And remember, that's less than 10%. CNBC reports Ford Motor, General Motors, Mercedes-Benz, Volkswagen, Jaguar Land Rover, and Aston Martin are all scaling back or delaying their electric vehicle plans. On Earth Day in 2022, a day not traditionally associated with the grand national security pronouncements, Biden said, "We're going to start the process for every vehicle in the United States military. Every vehicle is going to be climate friendly. Every vehicle, I mean it. We're spending billions of dollars to do it." Energy sector Granholm said the Biden admin set a 2030 target to switch all non-tactical military vehicles to electric. That's quite the opposite of what my colleagues across the aisle are saying. Our military, our Department of Defense, is for the defense of the United States, and their mission goal is to protect our national security, not to play climate politics. It is absolutely ludicrous that as we continue to waste our precious military resources in Ukraine, Joe Biden wants the military to rely on China, which is on track to control a third of the world's lithium by 2025, and to provide the materials for electric vehicles. China currently produces over 80% of the world's batteries. We don't need Americans' military to be dependent on China's batteries. Forcing the military to adopt unreliable electric vehicles would endanger the lives of service members and weaken our ability to defend ourselves from attacks. It also will waste money on an already failing industry that Americans just do not want to take part of. My amendment will ensure this charade is no longer funded. Madam Speaker, I reserve.
The gentlewoman reserves. And for what purpose does the gentleman rise?
I rise to claim the time in opposition and yield myself 2 minutes.
Okay, the gentleman from Washington is recognized for 2 minutes.
Thank you very much. This amendment would effectively ban electric vehicles and ban any effort to use them. Now, I will certainly agree that we are a long way off from having all electrical vehicles, but that's not what we're debating here. We're debating whether or not this should even be an option within the military. First of all, from a readiness standpoint, having options is always a positive thing. Energy is enormously important within the military. Having access to it can be difficult. And if you have electric vehicles as an option, that gives you one greater option so that you don't necessarily have to rely on fossil fuels to power a vehicle going forward. But more importantly, the basic debate over global warming, and that's what it is more than climate change, comes down to the belief that digging up fossil fuels from below the ground and burning them is bad for life. There's considerable evidence of this. It is placing carbon in the atmosphere that is damaging to the planet, and we need to develop alternatives so we are not 100% dependent upon fossil fuels. That's the basic plan here, to save the planet. which is actually kind of important to all of us, certainly to members of the military and certainly to the defense of our country. So eliminating this as an option goes in the exact wrong direction. Now, the General Lady is correct. It is an industry that is still struggling. The fossil fuel industry, the internal combustion engine, has a well over 150-year head start, has been very thoroughly subsidized across the board. But if you build more charging stations, if you build more electrical vehicles, it becomes more affordable and more viable. That's the entire point of this. This isn't going to happen tomorrow. We're not going to build all electric vehicles tomorrow. But why wouldn't we want that option to preserve our planet and move forward? An outright ban on electric vehicles within the military does not make sense. I urge members to oppose this amendment. And with that, I reserve the balance of my time.
The gentleman reserves, and the gentlewoman from Georgia is recognized.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Examples of the electric vehicle funding in this bill text are Joint Base Andrews, microgrid with electric vehicle charging infrastructure for $17.92 million. Joint Base Andrews is only 10 miles outside of Washington, D.C., in Maryland. This is the very base that if there was an attack on our nation's capital, Joint Base Andrews would be responding. Are we going to have to sit around and wait for our military members at Joint Base Andrews to charge their electric vehicles to come into the nation's capital to defend us in case of an attack? I don't think the American people want to spend almost $18 million for that. Joint Base McGuire-Dix Lakehurst in North Carolina is another example of funding. Microgrid with electric vehicle charging infrastructure of $17.73 million, and another enormous waste of money. At a time, Madam Speaker, where military recruitment numbers are at an all-time embarrassing low, Americans do not want to spend money to play climate politics. If we're going to spend more money on our Department of Defense, on our NDAA, why don't we pay military recruits more money instead of paying for electric vehicles and electric vehicle charging stations? That is an embarrassment, and I think it's an insult to the American people who work very hard to pay their taxes. Another little fact that everyone needs to know is there's a problem with electric vehicle charging stations. They don't always work. As a matter of fact, a recent number that came out is one out of every four electric vehicle charging stations do not work. So this is an investment into a system that isn't reliable, isn't proven, and is a massive waste of the American people's money.
The gentleman from Washington is recognized.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. I yield 2 minutes to the gentlelady from Virginia, Ms. McClellan.
The gentlewoman from Virginia is recognized for 2 minutes.
Thank you, Madam Chair and Ranking Member Smith. I have good news in that the NDAA does include a raise for our service members, which is long overdue, but we can multitask. And for all of the reasons that Ranking Member Smith said, it's important that we work to save our planet, because if we don't, it will have longer-term and short-term national security implications and implications for the readiness of our service members, which we heard in committee time and time again. But in addition to the climate benefits, EVs emit less noise and heat, so they're harder for our enemies to detect. They improve responsiveness and flexibility and decrease our reliance on fossil fuels, so that should fuel supplies ever be compromised or slow, our armed forces will still be able to respond because they have more options available. And yet, Republicans want to play politics with climate, not the Democrats. We are working to address climate change. We are looking to respond to climate change and make sure that our military remains ready and does not continue to contribute to global warming itself. As written, though, this amendment doesn't just block the DOD's adoption of electronic vehicles. It prohibits maintenance of existing EVs and charging infrastructure, or the potential installation of infrastructure that's already been secured but are subject to a servicing contract. Why in the world would we tie the hands of our military to maintain what they already have? That's just dumb. I don't understand why we're doing it. We shouldn't do it. Previous NDAs have contained provisions that addressed reasonable concerns related to the DOD's adoption of EVs including ensuring grid stability, proper phasing of support infrastructure, and resiliency planning. That's not here in this amendment. And the notion that EVs contain Chinese component parts and therefore are more of a threat than traditional internal combustion engines is specious. That argument could be used for every battery found in every vehicle, every phone, every computer, and almost anything that has a battery the DOD uses. I yield back.
The gentlewoman from Georgia expired. The gentleman from Washington.
I yield myself the balance of our time.
The gentleman is recognized.
Thank you. The biggest issue here is we keep hearing about climate politics. It's not climate politics. It's climate policy. And I've reminisced about this before, but back in the 2008 campaign, Republican nominee John McCain and his vice presidential nominee, Sarah Palin, were in favor of addressing climate change. It was a bipartisan agreement. But then Barack Obama had the nerve to get elected president and pursue those policies, and all of a sudden, it became partisan. All of a sudden, we decided that the planet isn't, in fact, warming, isn't, in fact, a problem, so we're just not going to worry about it anymore. But that doesn't change the basic facts that it is warming, and fossil fuels are contributing to that, and developing alternatives is going to be crucial to our national security going forward. This isn't politics, this is basic policy. And the lengths to which people opposed to these basic facts will go never ceases to amaze me. Like the argument that, oh my gosh, we can't have electric vehicles come to our aid because they'll be sitting there uncharged. Let me assure you that as basic readiness, they will be charged in the same way that the gas tanks are currently full, okay? It is not impossible to have electric vehicles work and function for us. They're doing it all over the world. Please reject this amendment and understand the need to get us to a more sustainable energy future. Time's expired.
The question is on the amendment offered